Quite frequently, people comment on my findings with Ethernet filters and audio grade switches. People that have serious education as network specialists that tell me that there can't be a difference in sound quality and I'm hearing things that are not there. They are wrong. There are sufficient audio files that confirm what I've been hearing over the last 6 years. But there are still people that either have no ears, don't trust their ears, have a poorly set up stereo, or can't look beyond their own discipline. The reproduction of music involves many disciplines: mechanics, electrics, electronics, acoustics, psychoacoustics, metallurgy, and even neuroscience. Thanks to the latter, we now know that the time resolution of our hearing is far higher than electronic engineers had concluded. In practice, this means that clock time variants of only a few picoseconds already have impact on the sound quality, provided you have a proper setup quality stereo. And then there are those that, unless I had performed a double blind test, are sure my observations are faulty. I had fallen into the trap of biased listening, or worse, was selling snake oil. If you take your work serious, like I do, quite insulting comments. Already 7 years ago, I made a video on double blind audio testing explaining why reviewers can't do double blind testing, simply because real scientific double blind testing requires too much personnel, too much money, and technical setup that is usually not achievable. See my video, the link is in the top right corner, in the description, and at the end of this video. Jitter causes distortion during the digital to analog conversion. Here, digital representations of analog voltages measured at precise time intervals are translated back to those analog voltages and rendered at the same time intervals. If those time intervals aren't exactly precise, the waveform will not be identical to the original. In other words, the sound will be distorted. The remarkable thing is that this kind of distortion cannot be measured with current distortion measurements. For as far as I now understand, this has to do with the essential differences in functioning of our hearing compared to measurement equipment. It appears that only a few picoseconds of jitter on the clock input of the DAC is audible. Could that be due to digital connections? How come a digital connection, including a network connection, can have, and often more than not, will have influence on the sound quality? It has puzzled me for a long time. I initially thought that jitter on the digital signal was the cause, but network specialists rightly pointed out that Ethernet and USB Audio Class 2 are asynchronous, and thus packets that are not sent against clock signal and therefore can't contain jitter. Isochronous digital connections like SPDIF, AES/EBU, TOSLINK and I2S are sent against the clock signal, but these can be buffered in receiving devices and then should have very low jitter when done properly. Measurements on isochronous digital connections show no serious jitter either. It was John R. Swenson that put me on the right track. I've mentioned his publication before. You'll find a link in the description. I've mentioned this before, digital signals don't exist. All so-called digital audio signals are analog square waves that are used to encode digital information in. High voltage is 1 and low voltage is 0. As with all analog signals, there is distortion and noise, but when used for digital information, that is of no consequence. As long as the square wave is above a threshold, it will still be interpreted as a 1, and below the threshold as a 0. The same goes for timing in asynchronous data transport. For isochronous data transport, things are different, as I have described in my video connecting your DAC number 2, how digital can go wrong. In short, noise, phase noise, limited bandwidth, wrong cable and connector impedance, they all influence the analog signal that transports digital audio. As long as the digital audio remains digital, there will be no problem. It's only when during the digital to analog conversion, noise or lifted ground level will shift the threshold and as a result cause jitter. Phase shift will cause jitter too. This all results in a distorted analog signal. We know this already for donkey years. In the past, I have published a magazine for the professional audio world for over two decades, and recently I came across a copy from 1991 that holds an article by Peter van Willenswaard, the technical editor back then, on digital audio and digital to analog conversion. To describe the influence of non-linearity and jitter on the conversion, he used an illustration by Arcam. The left figure shows the influence of non-linearity of the converter, the right one the effect of jitter, and in the middle the correct conversion. Let me add red lines with the correct curve and you see the effect immediately. My good colleague Jaap Veenstra of AlphaAudio.net has invested heavily in measuring this phenomenon, not only financially but also in time by studying many publications. He wanted to measure the jitter on the clock input of the DAC chip, since that will tell what's going on. It appeared to be extremely difficult. Initially, he was not able to reproduce measurements. One of the things he found out was that holding the test probe by hand influenced the measurement considerably. So he ordered a third hand, the blue gadget on the photo here, to hold the probe. That improved things, but not enough. He finally built an isolation box, a Faraday cage, with mains filtering and optimized the setup further by using several isolators. And he bought even more equipment. To give you an idea of the cost, only this module, an ultra-stable, oven-controlled crystal oscillator, costed $2,000. For more details, see his website, links in the description. He measured a number of combinations of switches, power supplies and a ping-phone isolator, and they all gave different jitter readings in the clock input of the DAC chip of a Vlumio Primo streamer. For instance, a consumer-grade D-Link switch with iFi power supply and ping-phone isolator gave 98.17 picoseconds of jitter. The Netgear with ping-phone isolator gave this reading, 56.52 picoseconds. Here we see the outcome of 10 setups he tested. I showed you the best and the worst measurement. Jaap is aware that there still are many things that has to be investigated, but there is a start. It proves that switches influence the amount of jitter on the clock input of a DAC chip, and thus that switches influence the sound quality, something people with ears already knew for years, including Jaap, but he took up the glove to prove it with measurements. He now even said that Ethernet cables can have an effect, and whether it's wired for 100 or 1000 Mbit, although these differences are smaller than switches and filters. Let me show you a video by Jaap showing how sensitive clock crystals are. It will also give you a glance of the isolation box he built. It shows why digital players and DACs should be placed on a sturdy underground and best placed on feet that absorb any vibrations, external or internal.
To give you an idea on how sensitive crystals actually are, this is noise right now. That's how sensitive a clock crystal actually is.
And on that bombshell, we come to the end of this video. There will be a new video next week. So subscribe to this channel or follow me on the Patreon, Facebook, LinkedIn or Instagram to stay informed on when new videos are out. Help me reach even more people by giving this video a thumbs up or link to this video on the social media. It is much appreciated. Many thanks to those viewers that support this channel financially. It keeps me independent and lets me improve the channel further. If that makes you feel like supporting my work too, the links are in the comments below this video on YouTube. I'm Hans Beekhuizen, thank you for watching, and see you next week. And whatever you do, enjoy the music.